Someone else I'm very pleased to introduce because I've known her for many years. Nancy Gallardo grew up in Michigan. She lives in Grand Rapids. She is an activist, a freelance theater arts instructor, a props designer, a radio programmer at WYCE, which is how I know Nancy. She served on the boards of West Michigan Pride and Ebony Road Players, and she recently received international attention on social media while standing up for the rights of Native Americans at the Standing Rock Reservations. Nancy describes herself as Indigenous, and about her experience at Standing Rock, she says, "I truly believe it was a calling of my great-grandmothers to be there." Nancy Gallardo.
Thank you so much. First of all, I want to thank everybody here, and it's wonderful that I know so many people, Fred and Teresa, Tommy, and I was a little nervous because my story isn't that funny, so I'm backstage and I'm telling Tim, it's not that funny, you know? I got this tattoo at age 16, and he goes, "Wow, you're such a rebel," and I'm going, "All right, okay." But all I'm thinking is, I gotta pee, and, water is life, Minnie McConaughey, So this is the story of how I got my first tattoo at age 16. All right, here we go. The Standing Rock tattoo is created by Stephanie, the Big Eagle, a descendant of the Oshete, Chicago, Sioux Nation tribe, and an Odapa movement participant. In the heart of there's a Thunderbird, it's a circle which represents the nations who have come together to stand for Standing Rock. And I got my tattoo on my last day at Standing Rock at the Oshete camp by a French journalist. Was a tattoo artist. Her name was Anella Nunes. So I actually got my tattoo. I only have these thin needles. I said, okay, it was my first tattoo. I have to do it four times. So yeah, that was a positive experience. I left Standing Rock on election day, on November. It was, I was traveling alone, but I the stops in Chicago, I met Nicole and Colin, Minnesota, I met Mary and Winter and Bismarck. I met Mariah, all headed to Standing Rock. And that's Mariah in the middle. On our first day at camp, we shared a tent together. Even though we had individual tents, we shared that tent together that first day. Mariah was arrested along with 40 other peoples the next day. The charges and the whereabouts were unknown. The Michigan host tent where he ended up all staying eventually was a home away from home from those in Michigan who traveled to support the fight at Standing Rock. My new friends became Michiganders. That's Nancy Shulman, our cook. I was later to be named the other Nancy. I took over the cooking duties after she returned. Nancy had been on many action calls and had even been arrested and released by the Morton County Police. She told of firsthand accounts of Dakota Access Pipeline dabble of security-seeking dogs and unarmed protesters, and of women being arrested and held in dog kennels with their hands tightly held by zip ties. And in early November, peaceful protesters crossed a makeshift bridge to Turtle Island, a sacred burial hill located northeast of camp. They were met at the banks by militarized police and dabble mercenaries who had already desecrated the sacred territorial land there. The Dakota Access Pipeline stretches across the north and south to north and south Dakota to Illinois. Originally, it was slated to run through Bismarck, a predominantly white community. They protested and feared that it might contaminate their drinking water. It was rerouted to the Sioux Reservation under the Cannonball River that runs to Missouri. That's their drinking water. A call to action echoed around the world to honor the future generations to fight for the pipeline, to protect water and all the sacred places. My heart felt that calling. I had to go there. On my first action call while at Standing Rock, we went to Mandan, a construction site where Dapple kept their digging equipment, and we went to pray at the entrance, and several people got injured by a construction worker who was decided to drive through us, and he shot guns and fired in the air. My second call to action was at Bismarck, to a courthouse and a jail. We wanted to find out what happened to our 40 friends who had been arrested earlier. That's Reba Lowe, a 93-year-old protester. She reminded me that activism is a lifetime commitment. My third call to action was on the bridge. There was one girl that was hit in the face by a tear gas cannon, another whose arm was blown off by a percussion grenade. My tentmate Noah was hit in the head by a rubber bullet. That's me on the left. After I was hit with a tear gas cannon to the chest and blasted by a water cannon, I made Rolling Stones magazine. It was the sub-zero temperatures, and I'd gotten sick from the tear gas and the water blast, and I had to go back to GR. It was 2:30 Thanksgiving Day that I arrived. My friend Ted Jaw, this dude over here, he drove me to the hospital. I had pneumonia, bronchospasms, a nose infection. Ted took that picture, by the way. Thank you, Ted. As I was in the hospital after being released, I spent the next 4 hours looking for a ride back to Standing Rock. I found a ride with the Michigan vets, and I was grateful. They had told me, and I told them they brought me to tears, and they said, "Wife, you're coming with us." That's Steve Perry, not the rock star. Steve Perry, the Michigan vet. I spent the next weeks in the kitchen of Michigan Ted cooking with Jessica Foster's and others under extreme cold conditions. Feeding the water protectors, the security, the medics, the construction crew, anyone who was hungry was fed. Standing Rock lives. There are many folks just like those who have gone to different places in the country to set up camps to protect the water, the sacred lands, the treaty rights. One small fire has created many. And there, we will find them. Just look online, you'll find all these camps are glorious. My last week there was during Christmas holiday. We made gifts to share, notebook cookies, okay, spaghetti dinner, cheesecake, anything that was no cook, that's what we pretty much cooked there. We comforted each other, and we became a family. We embraced each other. My last day there was a huge blizzard, and with a piercing, loud thunder clap, you could hear the voices throughout the camp cheering. It was a thunderbird, and he had spoken. I got my tattoo that day. My last call to action came after getting my tattoo. We heard the planes buzzing, and I couldn't wait to get out of that tent because I knew something was happening. I made it to Turtle Island. I crossed the plain. I walked over the Cannonball River, and I made it there. That was a bloody good day. I got my first tattoo at the age of 60 at Standing Rock, North Dakota. I will forever be a water protector because activism is a lifelong commitment.